We may have others who have concerns and troubles. Let us go before our God, who is well able, whose grace is sufficient for every situation and every circumstance. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, as we come to you, we give you thanks, Lord, for this opportunity that we have just to call upon your name, that name which is great and greater than all our sin, greater than all our troubles, greater than all our concerns, greater than all our doubts, greater than all our fears. Lord, in that great name we come to you this morning. Lord, even in our frail estate, while some may be afflicted in body, afflicted in mind, troubled in their spirit, God, your grace is sufficient to bring us through, to hold us, to sustain us. Lord, as we come before your presence, we stand, oh God, as an open book, that, Lord, you may look and see our needs, looking beyond our faults. We come before you, Lord, knowing that of ourselves, we surely would fail. Of ourselves, Lord, we can do nothing, but God, we know that through Christ we can do all things. We know, dear Lord, that our help comes from you. So, Lord, through the eyes of faith, we lift up our eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh our help. Our help cometh from the Lord, which made the heavens and the earth. We're grateful, O God, for this moment in time, for we invite your presence, O God, to fellowship with us, to commune with us, to tabernacle with us. For, O God, we long to be in your presence. God, that you may lead us in the paths of righteousness for thy name's sake. Help us, O God, to understand that you, O God, are able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we can ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. So cause our faith to look up to you, Lord. Help us not to look down at our troubles and our circumstances, but let us lift our eyes unto you, Lord God, where there is strength, where there is joy, where there is peace, where there is grace, where there is mercy, where there is blessing, O God. Help us, O God, that our trust would look unto you, that we might be the persons, the individuals, the collective church that you have called us to be, to show forth your praises, O God, in this dark world. We are so grateful and thankful for this moment in time. Remember these special requests that have gone forth, Lord, and I pray that you meet every need according to your divine will, that where there is sickness, healing might go in. Where there is bereavement, Lord, comfort might surround the family. Where there is difficulty, O God, I pray that you make an open door. Rest upon us today. These favors and blessings we with our scripture reading taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 1 through 10.
What a 64-year suit looks like.
Wow. You know, going to leave them off in disregard. Please come and let's welcome her and those who will bring special tributes to our dear beloved brother, friend, father, mentor, national hero.
Good morning, church. I'm very happy to be here this morning, and especially on this special event of my father's 90th birthday. Daddy, God has blessed you from December 2nd, 1927, up until this present time. And I'd like just to say a few words, not to wear your patience, about Daddy. This has been a very memorable day for all of us, and instead of us sprinkling here and there, coming in for a few here and there days, and some of us for Christmas and some not because of work schedules, and we're scattered in two states of the United States and the Bahamas, and so sometimes, convenient to be here all at the same time. But this year, for his birthday, he says, I would be very pleased if all of you could be here for my birthday. Never mind Christmas if you could come, fine. But for my birthday, I would be very happy if all of you would be here. And thank God we are all here today. It's a milestone to be 90 years old. And in this congregation and other congregations around the world, there are other 90-year-old fathers and mothers, and some of you are privileged to have your father and mother still with you at 90 years old. I am very privileged to have Daddy here at 90 years old. He has been his given name, Joseph James McDonald Swann, and we ask him, why do you have all these names? Well, because he's a very special person, and all of those names mean something. He's a very loved and loving man, and you know the virtue of that. And he's lived a remarkable life of praise and worship to God in this church and worldwide. He's been in quite a few places around the world, and I'm sure that you've seen how adventurous he is at times, having traveled to places like the Middle East, where he jumped up on a camel and rode a camel, and being adventurous also as in his family, they have a special time of the year for, they call it the nephews and uncles trip, annual trip every year. And one of those years, they took a picture of Daddy going on a zip line. And I'm sure some of you have seen probably those pictures around, and it was very daring. I wouldn't try it, but he's very daring, and he tried it. So he is not so well-versed in fear, it seems. Like a child who you have to take his hand away from a fire, he is not afraid to go and be daring. He's been a family man all his life that I know. He's the father of 10 children. And we had a little reception yesterday morning. And I asked the question, why would you have 10 children? So there's a lot of history behind that, knowing that his mother died at a very young age, and at that time his father wanted to be married again, and so he was gifted to the Rigby family, who is part of our immediate family here today. God bless them too. And so he says, well, I needed a lot of love, so I had a lot of kids. And so, Daddy, you have a lot of love, and that's exponentially so, He has teached and preached and reached tens of thousands. He's a lover of young and old, and a great encourager to those who propagate the gospel of Jesus Christ. He loves and respects his time on earth, and uses it well as an avid reader every day, and a perennial gardener who knows the value of the soil and its yield. In his life of service to his mankind, I'm sorry, just a moment, I have my glasses, I'm trying to be brave. He has rarely missed a nightly scheduled service and takes the responsibility of leadership very seriously. I'm sure you're well aware of that. In mentoring the emerging and potential ministers, he admonishes them to continuously pray. And in the words of Paul, some may plant, some may water, but God gives the increase. And today, as you celebrate the 90th birthday, Daddy, continue to love, worship, and give glory and praise to the God who gives you all things. I thank you for your time and patience, and God bless you, and have a wonderful day.
Joseph James MacDonald Swann, who does the worst you might accomplish in this life, only what the doctrine of the Lord loves. And you have to wait for the for them that way for them. Place their part of that living as it is not yours. You pay the tithes to support the work of the Lord. You live for him and wait for him. That is coming. You will live for him forever. That's my design for all of my family. Live for him because it's my desire to live in the Lord, not to be in this world. It's not my home. I am only passing through him. My treasures are laid up. And that's exactly how it is. You might have finance, you might have good education, you might not have things, but all of those things will vanish. All of the stadium, only the things that is done for Christ will last.
Thank you. Thank the Lord for another day that he has made, and we will rejoice and be glad. And we thank God for the 90 years, Bishop Swann. We celebrate with you today and others who are celebrating birthdays. We thank God for another day. We thank God for another day. If you happen to be here, jump to your feet and shout hallelujah. Let us jump to our feet and say glory to God. God is good. He is good all the time. I really love the Lord because he has been good to me. God is good and he's good all the time. My Jesus, I love thee.
The flu dropped down on me, but I said it ain't no flu gonna stop my fortune to praise the Lord every day and in every situation. I lay in the circumstances. We prepare our hearts now for the word of God, which will be delivered today by Bishop Nathaniel Beneby, Jr. I invite you to bow in prayer as we prepare for the word. Heavenly Father, we approach your throne of grace again, grateful for the opportunity to enter these gates with thanksgiving and to enter these courts, hallelujah, with praise. We are thankful.
Vice President for Royal Bank of the Bahamas, Ophelia, don't know if she made it, or Bonnet or Crystal. And I invited her because during a senior leadership meeting a couple of weeks ago, when we were talking about leadership, that group came up with a word, resiliency. And I was inspired to make that the third point of my message this morning. And I told them that. But she didn't make it. I'll have to tell her about it. Or maybe one of you will have to tell her about it so I don't appear to be talking about myself too much. But I also want to thank our pastor. I believe God has directed him. And I say that for any number of reasons, but for two in particular. January 8th of this year, the first month, I don't know if he recalls that he had asked me to preach the sermon on a Sunday morning, the beginning of the new year. And my subject then was, "Great is our God and worthy of all praise." Psalms 145. And then this last Sunday, in the last month, sorry, the first Sunday in the last month of this year, he's asked me to share the word. And then when I read the bulletin this morning, as I was meditating, I thought, should I reflect on the current environment to introduce my subject, "My grace is sufficient for thee"? And I said, well, I didn't want to sound too secular. But when I read the bulletin message this morning, it confirmed that the Spirit is working. And I got the freedom of the Spirit to proceed. And so just before I get into the word, I also want to tell you all my wife, where she's over here, 37 years. She celebrates her birthday tomorrow. And 37 years plus 6 years dating her. I always add that in. And that's a 43-year relationship. So she and I are proving to the young marriage folks that marriage still works. And we ain't so old yet. And so I really love you, and we look forward to celebrating tomorrow, whatever that means. So, "My grace is sufficient for thee." And when our pastor asked me to speak, as I was going home that Sunday morning, I said this to my wife, I said, "Riggles," I said, "I want to reflect on forgetting those things that are behind and looking forward." Because I know not a lot of us would want to. We're happy to see 2017 getting ready to leave us. But I can tell you 2018 is not going to be too much different. And so I was praying, she and I were having morning prayers. This subject came to me, "My grace is sufficient for thee," because we're going to need this in 2018. And so as an introduction, see, this week we met with Standard and Paul. And they and us were opining on the Bahamas. You know, they have us as rated as subpar grade investment, credit reading, but they like some of the positive things that are happening. Government, fiscal discipline, and the recent consolidation of the $750 million bond. So I'm talking to you now as a brothers and sisters and a minister. I'm not talking to you as managing director, president of RBC. I just want to put that disclaimer in there. I'm talking to my brothers and sisters in Christ. That's okay? So, and then the first 3 months, they've had budget surpluses, this new government, which is a positive thing that hasn't happened in many years. Because that bond word was no new debt, that was just a consolidation. You know, like an individual, when you have plenty of debt, you want to consolidate to prove the payment and so you can meet recurring expenses. And the current budget surplus is because they have deferred paying a lot of the debt left by the previous fellows. So, in spite of what appears to be a positive, progressive trend, with IMF predicting this year 1.7% growth, 2.5 next year, that 2.5 would still be not sufficient to reverse the high unemployment we are experiencing in this country. And so in 2018, my brothers and sisters, we must continue to be prudent and careful. It's painful when we hear about the redundancies and the job losses, but that's the Scots emulsion we must take right now. Some of you don't know Scots emulsion. I was sick one time and my wife tried to get me to drink that. And every time I tried to drink it, I feel my stomach coming out of control. So I had to hold my nose and swallow it hard. She said, "Nah, this will cure you." The country is trying to digest Scots emulsion right now. But that is why the current government has no choice. As painful as it is with the job losses, it's painful now, but it's for a long term good. So, this is really trying to help us Christians to settle ourselves and to know that we must depend on God and avoid the anxiousness, the impatience and the intolerance, because God's grace is sufficient for thee. Hallelujah. Grace means favor or kindness shown without regard to worth or merit of one who receives it, and in spite of what that person desires. Grace, for the most part, is associated with mercy, love, compassion, and patience. The sufficiency of God's grace means it's enough to meet the needs of any and every situation. Grace counters legalism. It brings liberty, freedom from slavery or bondage, freedom from oppression, freedom from tyranny of others' opinions, and freedom from sin's power and guilt. Defining grace as it relates to our salvation in Ephesians 2, 8 through 10, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus
unto good works, which God had before ordained that we should walk in them. Let's say thank God for his amazing grace. Lord, we thank you. As we come before your presence, Lord, God, you have created us. You know the end. You do all things well. But we come standing in need. Lifting up, Lord, our dear sister, Mrs. Swann family. Thank you for her ministry and her life. Strengthen her frail body. We pray that your perfect will be done. For that is the kingdom of power. Amen. Let's say thank you, Lord. In the text, Paul is writing about his vision and revelations of the Lord. In verse 2, to avoid bringing attention to himself, Paul refers to himself in the third person. I know a man in Christ about 14 years ago, whether in the body, I cannot tell, or whether out of the body, I cannot tell. God knoweth such an one caught up in the third heaven. He describes himself as being in paradise and heard things so extraordinary and astounding that they were beyond his comprehension to describe in words. And Paul goes on to say, even if I was able to describe it, I was not allowed to tell others what he had heard, what I had heard. Paul goes on to say, verse 5, the experience is something worth bragging about. But I am not going to do that. I'm going to boast only about how weak I am and how great God is to use such weakness for his glory. Paul recognizing this special privilege and blessing of a vision of heaven in humility, he repeats again in verse 6. I have plenty to boast about and would be no fool in doing it. But I don't want anyone to think more highly of me than he should from what he actually can see in my life and my message. My Lord. To help Paul from becoming prideful, boastful, and perhaps a Gnostic, God allowed Paul to be given a physical condition, which was a thorn in his flesh, a messenger from Satan to hurt and bother him and to prick his pride. Paul does not describe this thorn as an affliction or sickness, nor did the Bible say what this thorn was. Some expositors describe the thorn as an irritation, something which annoys and frustrates. This annoyance, this irritation frustrated Paul so much that he prayed for the Lord to take it away from him. Three times he pleaded with God for relief. But God answers, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. And then Paul submitted to the divine will of God. What did he say in verse 9? Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distress, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, speculate what Paul's thorn could have been. In fact, church, by not describing the thorn, it could be anything, and no one is immune from it. Because if that thorn was described, I would say, well, that ain't for me. I'm not having that problem. Or you might say, that's not for me. I'm not having that problem. So I can see the wisdom in this thorn not being described. For some of us Christians, a thorn is not a bad thing. Paul had this wonderful experience, and he recognized and knew himself that if he's not careful, pride can hurt him. And so he pleaded to the Lord, "Help me, Lord.
Come on, sister.
this to the relevancy of our day, what's happening in our current environment. I don't want to be abstract much and feel so good for what happened back over 2,000 years ago. We can show what was happening today. In our country, why many people are doing well, and we praise God for them. Official stats tell us 71% of people live below the poverty line of $11.64 a day. Many thousands go to bed or go to school hungry. Hundreds have lost their homes because of an inability to make mortgage payments through no fault of theirs. I believe people are fundamentally good and always want to do the right thing, but they are victims of unemployment, underemployment, or defaults. These are the top three reasons for the extent of non-approvals, delinquency, and home ownership and obligations we see in our country today. Thousands are without electricity or are on worker payment plans, paying a little at a time. Unemployment among male youth is pegged at close to 30% and growing. And another area that's not talked about much is thousands of people are facing the fear of retirement who are not ready to retire. And that one is being underrepresented in the country. And we, the baby boomers, there's plenty of us. And you would have heard like me, NIB must do something soon, otherwise they will run out of money. And you're pensioning immediately. You. My grace is sufficient. Oh, Lord have mercy. My grace is sufficient. They will have to reduce benefit or increase premium. Pretty soon. I spoke to an actuary, and he confirmed that to me. One of the two things that have to happen. See, what I'm trying to help us with churches, I'm trying to help us Christians to be settled, to trust God more. Because he is the supply, and he knows all about us. And I want us to be more thankful.
That's why you should keep checking it.
Paul saying, in everything, give thanks. But this is the will of God. So regardless of what the situation is, when we complain, we say, God, you already know everything about me. But God knows everything, my brothers and sisters. And on the other hand, there are thousands of persons who are sick, and they're experiencing thorns or fears and disappointments and heartbrokenness. And the thing we desire most continues to elude us. We constantly pray for healing, for relief, for resolution, and answer to the problems. But we're going to have to live with some of these irritations, vexing problems, and nagging problems. Whatever your circumstances may be, Jesus gives his assurance, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Let me see the hands of those who truly trust in God. Truly trust in God. Hallelujah. Look at the witnesses. My Lord. Let's give them a round of applause. But Jesus cannot bend, you know. And he can't let us down. And I'm trusting him every day. Because he will take care of me. And he will take care of every situation. And so, I leave you with three thoughts. Grace is an enabler. Jesus gave his disciples enabling grace in Luke 10, 9, which is available to us today. Behold, I give unto you power to tread over serpents and scorpions and over all power of the enemy. And nothing, say with me, church, nothing. Or say that with an attitude. Do like this. Man, you gotta believe that. Shall by any means
As Jesus sent his disciples to witness, he told them that he was sending them as lambs among wolves. Speak peace wherever you go, and heal the sick. They were obedient. As a result, they were effective, enjoying good success and wonderful experiences. In verse 17, the disciples said, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. Jesus then enables them with greater offensive and defensive power to win over the enemy. Jesus said, behold, I give unto you power to tread over serpents and scorpions and over all of the enemy. The disciples were enabled with offensive power to go after and be aggressive to the enemy. You know, sometimes we have to be aggressive. Championship really happens being offensive and defensive. Like David went after Goliath, sling and the stool. He didn't take a defensive posture. He was aggressive. And sometimes you have to be aggressive to sing. And then he gave the disciples defensive power. What a winning combination. Jesus said, nothing shall by any means hurt you, not wicked men or serpents and scorpions. And listen to this. That's why you can't do it now. I mean, say that to yourself. You tell it somebody else. You just say that, you can't do it now. Oh my Lord. You may just say, I mean, you can't do nothing now. You may despise their rage, ignore them. The servants may issue, but they can't hurt you. This is God's divine protection. When I was writing this, my mind reflected on a wife when she was at C.B. Bethel. God was protecting her. That school still has a record of C average. No public school has topped that, has matched that yet. And when that she closes that gate in the morning, she has been established. She's the maximum leader. And the administrative staff didn't like the discipline, Bishop Wright. They didn't like the discipline. So, and then there was someone who didn't like to talk about fixing you. And so, when she went to work this morning, by her door, she meet Benny, spread in front of her door, Benny. And I don't know, they must have used Benny to fix you, I don't know. She saw this. So she called the secretary and said, some dirt down here, come sweep this up. Sweep this up, move this out of the way. She didn't even recognize it. What I'm saying is, God was divinely protecting her. And when I say the enemy could embrace you and kiss you, but they can't destroy you, that's God's divine protection. He's our refuge and he's our strength. Time of trouble. That's why I love him so. Hallelujah. Not only God's grace is an enabler, God's grace is a preserver. Perseverance is the steadfast effort to follow God's commands and to do his work. To preserve us as a Christian, we need more than just faith alone.